Hello, my dear students. With respect to our last class, we have successfully ended out with our module 3 there, which was all about the study regarding deadlock as a section, and one more was memory management. Okay, so we have come across now to handle, or else to get to know, what do you mean by deadlock and how and deadlock can be handled there. Different method for that, and in that one of the basic method was your Banker's algorithm. Okay, so along with that, we had come across with memory management, how and memory is been managed across by an operating system, wherein we had come across with the terms like it can be fragmentation, the terms like segmentation, paging. Okay, so these all things. So with the same reference, with an extension to the paging as a term, which you already learnt in your module 3, is an extension which you are studying even in your module 4, and that is all regarding virtual memory management and file system. Okay, so this is your module 4, and in that there are it's an encapsulation of two chapters, chapter 9 and chapter 10 respectively. Okay, and only some sections are there from chapter 9 and some sections are there from chapter 10. Okay, so first let us deal with virtual memory here. Okay, so virtual memory nowadays, it has become the most used one, or else in an advanced sections there. Okay, in my classes also I had said you how and virtual memory plays a very important role. Okay, so one of the best examples which we are using now is cloud. Okay, so with respect to the cloud, or its cloud computing ultimately says that you are storing across the information in a cloud, and that can be accessed being anywhere at any time. Okay, so the same things here also with respect to your virtual memory. Okay, so let us come across with this slide with respect to your virtual memory there. Okay, so in this we will be coming across with what do you mean by one of the important one called as demand paging. Okay, then you'll come across to know what do you mean by copy on write. Okay, so and one more you are coming across with what do you mean by page replacement. Okay, so page replacement, or and you're coming across with the page replacement algorithm also. Okay, so I'll divide this session into two videos there of your memory management, of your virtual memory, because all at a time, if I say even to understand also, it becomes little bit tough. Okay, so we'll have some sections in today's class. Okay, then little later sections we'll have in another class. Okay, so page replacement, algorithms for page replacement, okay, allocation of frames you are studying, then what do you mean by thrashing. Okay, you are studying these all things over here. Okay, so let us come across, of course, objectives are you are getting to know what are the benefits of your virtual memory system. Okay, you are getting across to know the concepts like demand paging, page replacement algorithm, as I said just now. Okay, the same things there. Okay, so followed out with that, let us come across with the very first one. Okay, what do you mean by virtual memory? Always keep in mind, virtual memory is a technique, okay, that allows the execution of processes that are not completely in the memory. I'm not having these processes completely in my physical storage, or else in my physical memory. Okay, so one major advantage of this scheme is you do not have a larger capacity of your physical memory. As and when that particular process needs an memory allocation, only at that time it has been allocated and the program gets executed there from that process. Okay, so this is advantage of your virtual memory. Okay, so virtual memory is separation of user logical memory from physical memory. Okay, only part of the program needs to be in the memory for execution. Only part of that program. I need not have the whole content of the program for my execution. I'll be having part of it. Okay. Then comes logical address space can therefore be much larger as compared to your physical address space there. Okay. It allows the address space to be shared by several processes. Several processes are sharing the same respective address space there. Okay. It allows for more efficient process creation. More processes can run concurrently because there will be sharing there. So ultimately more programs will run concurrently there. Less input output is needed to load and swap the processes. Okay. So what do you mean by this virtual address space? Virtual address space is nothing but it's a logical view of how process is stored in the memory. Okay. So usually it starts at the address zero, that is with contiguous address until the end of space. Meanwhile, your physical memory is organized in page frames there. MMU, okay, that is memory management unit, must map logical to physical. Okay, so that's the one which is responsible. Okay, virtual memory can be implemented via two things, okay, which are studying. One is called as demand paging and one more is called as demand segmentation. Okay, so virtual memory, as I said you just now, that is usually larger than the physical memory. What you are saying, you can just come across, this is your memory mapping, okay, this is your physical memory, okay, whereas this is my memory storage which I'll be having, this is my virtual memory now. Okay, so you can just come across, it is page 0, page 1, page 2, so on, okay, virtual memory till page V. Okay, so ultimately we come across with a conclusion saying about that there are the size over of your virtual memory is greater than the physical memory. Okay, so this is an it shows the general layout of virtual memory, which can be much larger than the physical memory. Okay, so here you can just come across that why most real processors do not require all their pages now. Ultimately, the very first reason is error handling code is not needed until that specific errors occur. Okay, some of which are quite very rare. Okay, whereas certain features of certain programs are very rarely used. So that's why I'll be requiring only some part of it. Okay, the ability to load only the portions of the processes that are actually needed has some benefits there. What are those benefits now? Programs could be written for much larger address space than physically exists on the computer, because each process is only using a fraction of the total address space, there is more memory left for other programs to execute. Okay, this will ultimately improve your CPU utilization and system throughput. Okay, lesser input output is needed for swapping processes in and out of RAM. Okay, ultimately it speeds up the process. Okay, so this is one of the advantages what we are coming across. Okay, so then comes regarding virtual address space now. Okay, so with respect to your virtual address space, you can just come across this one. Okay, you already come across this as the segments of memory storage. Okay, that's with code segment, data segment, heap segment, and stack segment. Okay, wherein you can just see here between the stack and the heap, there is a large hole here. Okay, this hole is specially we are keeping in consideration of this as with a term we call it as sparse there. Okay, it enables a sparse address space with holes left for growth dynamically linked libraries there. Okay, so we can use dynamic memory allocations to use this sparse address space there. Okay, so it is a great hole in the middle of the address space which is never used unless the stack or its heap segment grow to fill that particular hole there. Okay, virtual memory also allows to share of the files and memory by multiple processes there, okay, with several benefits. System libraries can be shared by mapping the system libraries, whatever are there. Okay, so they can be shared by mapping them into the virtual address space of one or more processes. Okay, process pages can be shared during a fork system call. Okay, now like for example, here you are coming across shared memory by mapping pages read write into virtual address space there. Pages can be shared during fork, okay, which will ultimately speeding the process creation. What do you mean by fork now? Fork is used for process creation. Okay, so ultimately pages which will be there, they'll be shared between the parent and the child processor. So that is a one next thing what you are studying here. Shared library using virtual memory. These are your shared pages now. Okay, between them there lies a library which has been created called a shared library between two processes. Now this I can catch as for one process, this as for one more process. I can say that there exists a shared pages between them. Okay, so this thing is one of the advantages whenever I say regarding process creation. Okay, now next let's come across to know what do you mean by demand paging. Okay, you already come across to know what do you mean by paging now. Okay, I'm prefixing the paging as a term with demand. So demand ultimately says that as and when needed. Okay, the basic idea behind demand paging is that when a process is swapped in, its pages are not swapped in all at once. Okay, it could bring the entire process into memory at the load time or bring a page into memory only when it is needed. Okay, only when it is needed it will be taken across. Okay, by doing so, what are the benefits now? Less input output is needed. Okay, no unnecessary input output. Okay, less memory is needed. You can have faster responses. You can have more number of users. Okay, you can just see here, it's my main memory. I have this particular section, grade structure is program A. This grade structure is program B. Okay, what do I do? I have these on my pages now, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. These are swapped out of program A. Whereas what are swapped in now? 17, 18, 19 are being swapped in from the program B. Okay. Similar to your paging system with swapping. Okay. It's with the, there you had come across in paging called it as roll in and roll out. Okay. Here we are coming across with the word called it as swap in and swap out. Okay. So page is needed, okay, reference to it. Invalid reference is nothing but abort, okay, or else not in memory, okay. Bring back to, if you want to execute it, you have to bring it to the memory, okay. So I usually call this demand paging as a lazy swapper, okay. Why it is called it as lazy swapper? It never swaps a page into memory until the page will be needed. Until the page is needed, you are not swapping it, okay. Swapper that deals with the pages is a pager. I use a term called out as pager for me. Okay. Then these are some basic concepts with regard to your demand paging there. What is that? So they say that instead you can just see that paper pager guesses which pages will be used before swapping out. Okay, it guesses which pages can be used further. Okay. So pager brings in only those pages into memory. Okay. How to determine that set of pages? This is how your MMU functions and implement a demand paging. Okay, if pages are needed, okay, and which are already residing, they are called out as memory resident pages. Okay, no difference from non-demanding pages. I'm assigning them as memory resident. They are already lying there. Okay, if page needed and not a memory resident, you need to detect that, load the page into memory from the storage. Okay, but keep in mind this should not affect your program behavior. Or is without programmer needing to change any kind of code for this. Okay, so here I can just come across. We have already come across as valid and invalid bits. Remember back. Okay, your page table. Okay, so your page table is a combination of two things. One is page number. One more is frame numbers. Along with frame numbers, we had a bit flag which said V and I. V stands for valid bit. I stands for invalid bit. Okay, so here V is nothing but valid. And it is already residing, that is memory resident. Okay, I is invalid bit and which says that it is not in memory. Okay, initially is all your valid and invalid bits are all set to I only. Okay, as and when a page table is being allocated and a page is being referred through the frame numbers. Okay, so what will happen? That page is referring to this particular frame number. Okay, then this flag will be changed from I to V. This is from I to V like this. Okay. And which are not referred will be back with the same status called out as I there. Okay. During MMU address translation, if valid invalid bit in page table entry is I, then I call it across with this term called out as page fault. Okay, it's a page fault for me. Okay, so wherein I need to address it. Okay, page table when some pages are not in the main memory there. You can just see that it's in your logical memory. There are 8 pages which I'm referring here from A to H. Okay, my page table is with a reference followed as these are my page numbers, these are my frame numbers, these are valid and invalid bits there. Okay, you can just find it. Page number 0 is with at the frame number 4. Page number 2 is with the frame number followed as 6. And this is with 9. Okay, only these I will turn from I to V. Okay, the same thing is allocated here. Okay, but when you go across with the memory storage, you can just see that there are few more others which are already there. Okay, so those things act and that is nothing but for all of them, you are having an allocation here. Okay, but that's in your memory storage, it is there. Okay, but as and when required, it will be addressed in the page table and that will be addressed in the physical memory. Only then it will redirect to the memory of that particular page. Okay, so this is a small example there, not in the main memory. Okay. Then comes the word called as page fault. What do you mean by this? Okay, if there is a reference to a page, first reference to that page will be trapped to operating system. Okay, if the page is needed that was not originally loaded up, then a page fault trap is generated. Okay, so ultimately it says that your respective page fault. Okay, so or else I call it across with a page fault trap then. Okay, it is usually handled in a series of steps. The very first step is operating system looks for another table to decide invalid reference, that is abort, okay, which is just not in memory at all. Okay, okay? And the second one is, it starts finding out for a free frame, okay? As soon as it finds a free frame, it swaps that particular page into frame via the scheduled disk operation, okay? Then what does it do is, it resets the tables to indicate page now in memory and set the validation bit as V, okay? Then again, it restarts the instruction that caused the page fault. Okay, these are your five respective steps which are undergone for any page fault trap there. Then comes, the same thing is being demonstrated with a block diagram here. You can just see that my first very reference is load M. Okay, so when you load M, so it's nothing but your page table is referred. Initially, it's with I. Okay, that's an invalid reference. So as soon as invalid reference is there, I say that it's a page fault. It's been trapped. Okay, it's been trapped, identified by the operating system. What will operating system do now? Page is on the backing store. In the respective backing store, that particular page is available now. Okay, so this page is bring in the missing page there. Okay, it is brought back into the physical memory. Okay, only when it finds a free frame there. Okay, as soon as it finds a free frame from the backing store, that particular page has been brought and it has been allocated here. Okay, once it has been allocated, what is the next work? What do? You reset the page table. Okay, you reset the page table is nothing but priorly it was with I, now it will be changed with V because it's been allocated now. Okay, then you restart the instruction again. This will be going on for the next respective load, for the next respective instruction, like this. Okay. So this particular thing, okay, I call it across in other words as pure demand paging also. Okay, so extreme case. Now start process with no pages in the memory at all. Okay, so where there are no pages at all. Okay, so I call that one as a pure demand paging. There, OS sets instruction pointer to first instruction of process. Okay, so wherein it says across as there are no, or else there is such a slow performance, or else whenever a page fault occurs there, okay, and the system has to go get into the memory. There are many steps that occur when servicing a page fault, and some of the steps are optional or variable there. Okay, so what happens is the same things. Actually, a given instruction could assess multiple pages, multiple page faults. Consider fetch and decode of instruction which adds two numbers from memory and stores result back to memory. Okay. Now this is being referred as locality of reference. Okay, and the hardware support which is needed for your demand paging is, one is in your page table with valid and invalid bit. Second one is secondary memory swap design. That's a swap device with a swap space is required, and instruction restart. Okay, these are few aspects of demand paging which has to be followed. Okay, in the same. If at all you come across with this particular blockage, okay, which says that I have a rectangular box to another and it has been referred to itself, okay, it's nothing but consider an instruction that could assess several different locations, okay, block move, auto increment decrement location, you are restarting that particular instruction there, okay, restart the whole operation again. What if source and destination overlap in the case, okay? That is how we are judging across by the performance of this demand paging. Okay, that is, these are the stages which are being considered for the worst case. What is that? First one is you trap to the operating system saying what that it is an invalid entry. Okay, you save the user registers and process state. In what state has it been appeared and what is the present status of the register? Okay, determine that the interrupt was a page fault. Then what you do is check that the page reference was legal and determine the location of the page on the disk. Okay. Then what you do is you issue a read from the disk to a free frame where you find a free frame then. Okay. Then you wait back in a queue. Okay. And until this device completes its read request there. The second one is you wait for the device seek or the latency time. Okay. Then what you do is you begin the transfer of the page to a free frame. Okay, while till you're waiting, okay, you allocate the CPU to some other user there. Okay, yes, it can be receive an interrupt from the disk input output system. Okay, you save the registers, process state for other user. Okay, determine that the interrupt was from the disk. Then correct the page table and other tables to show page is now in memory wait for the CPU to be allocated to this process again, restore the user registers, process state, new page table, and then resume the interrupted instruction. Okay, these are the several steps or stages which are included in your demand page. Okay, along with that, you'll be here to usually your page fault rate, or it's three major activities. Okay, one is service the interrupt. Okay, second one is read the page. Third one is restart the process. Okay, your usually page fault rate is between lies between 0 and 1. 0 says no page faults. 1 says every reference is a fault. Okay, you are finding across with EAT here. That is effective SS time. How is it been given? It has been given as 1 minus P, that's a page fault rate, okay, into memory SS, okay, plus page fault, okay, page fault rate, okay, into page fault overhead plus swap page out plus swap page in. Okay, this will give you, these are all in terms of seconds, okay, will be given to you, and using those values you can find the effective SS time. Okay, an example is given here. Okay, you can just look across. Okay, memory SS time is 200 nanoseconds. Okay, your average fault service time is 8 milliseconds. Okay, he has taken out that, contributed that, and you are getting across with an answer. If one SS out of 1000 causes of page fault, then EAT is 8.2 microseconds. Okay, so like this, you can come across. Okay, let us come across with the next one. Okay, which says copy on write. Okay, what do you mean? Where does this actually plays a role? Is as I had spoke to you in the class regarding fork. Okay, similarly, I had even said to you regarding VFork. Okay, VFork is nothing but wherein the child writes in the address space of the parent itself. So your it creates a copy on that particular write, and that has been allocated. Okay, COW, that is copy on write, allows both parent and child process to initially share the same page in memory. Okay, you are sharing the same page of the memory in the case of VFork usually. Okay, so if either process modifies a shared page, only then is the page being copied. Okay, COW allows more efficient process creations as only modified pages are copied. Okay, free pages are allocated from a pool of zero fill on demand pages there. Okay, so it's like VFork, variation on fork system call. Okay, has parent suspended and child using copy on write address space of parent. Okay, designated to have child call EXEC. It's very efficient one. Okay, so usually we do not use VFork as compared to fork there. Okay, only because it's using the virtual address space of the parent as compared to the child there. Okay, if the child makes any kind of changes, okay, in the space allocated, so ultimately the whole program will be affected. Okay, so now, like for example, before process one modifies C now. This is process one, this is process two, this is your physical memory. Okay, so after process one modifies page C now. Okay, page C has been modified by process 2. Okay, but whereas it has created a copy of that particular page C with it. Okay, a copy is already available and the changes are done over here. Okay, so this is what we are coming across with your process 1. Okay, so the next one demand is, if there is no free frame, so at that time what we have to do. Okay, when there are no free frames, there comes this word called as page replacement. Okay, if there are no free frames, I cannot allocate directly a page to a respective process. So at that time, what you can do is, you can make that particular page to be replaced. Okay, in that page, for how many frames will it be? Okay, that frame, take it off. Okay, and allocate that particular frame to another respective process. Okay, that can be done. Okay, so that you are coming across in your further slides with page replacement algorithms there. Okay, so page replacement is nothing but prevention of over allocation of memory by modifying the page fault service. Okay, okay, so we use an modified dirty bit to reduce overhead of page transfers. Only modified pages are returned to the disk here. Okay, so you can just come across. Okay, it is loading up of M. Okay, for user one, this is for user. So it is having the page table for user one. Okay, one respective frame entry is found out here. Okay, it will load that M here. Okay, here B is there. Okay, B also should have been loaded here, but it is kept back in the respective backing storage. Okay, so regarding these, we'll come across with the three algorithms there. Okay, so with that page replacement. Okay, so what the basic steps for page replacement is, find the location of the desired page on the disk, find a free frame. If there is a free frame, use it. Okay, if there is no free frame, use a page replacement algorithm to select a victim frame. Okay, write the victim frame to disk if dirty. Okay, bring the desired page into the free frame, update the page and frame tables. Okay, continue the process by restarting the instruction that caused the trap. Note, now potentially two page transfers for page fault, increasing E8 ultimately. Okay, page replacements are nothing but, okay, here you find that this F is a frame. Okay, it was with valid. Okay, you can just come across it. And victim. Okay, here swap out of the victim page. Okay, then what you do is change to invalid now. You are changing it back to invalid. Okay, because you are finding that one space is there. Okay, then you swap that desired page in. Okay, then reset the page table for the new page. Okay, that's your page replacement. Okay, just you can just come across the frame allocation algorithms. Determines how many frames to give for each process, which frames to replace. Okay, there are three things what you fellows are coming across. One is FIFO, that stands short for first in first out page replacement algorithm. Second one is optimal. Okay, and the third one is LRU, least recently used. Okay, you'll come across one by one. Okay, with the same things there. Okay, so in the further example, you can just see that this is a reference string which has been considered there. Okay, for these reference string, you are creating the page replacement algorithm. Okay, let's come across with the very first example of FIFO. Okay, so reference string is so and so. Okay, consider that there are three frames. Okay, and three pages can be in the memory at a time per process. Okay, we can just come across three frames. He has said 1, 2, and 3. Okay, so it stands out for this is your. This happens to be a 1, okay. This happens to be a 1, okay. This happens to be a 2, this happens to be a 3, okay. This is 1, this is 2, okay, and this is 3. Okay, these are three frames, okay. First, you have a reference string called out as 7, okay. You give an input to it, 7 is allocated first, okay. Then comes 0, okay. 7, 0 has been allocated. Then comes third one, 1, okay. 7, 0, 1. My all three frames are allocated now. Okay. Now, when there comes a next string which has to be allocated, so at that time, which respective frame will I be changing? Okay. So, what will I do? First in, first out. Which was first in here? First in was 7. So, I'll remove that 7, replace it with 2. Okay. Go to shift to the next one. Okay. Next one is 0 now. Okay, so when it comes across with 0, okay, so when it comes across with 0 here, so get to know when it comes across with 0, 0 is already there, okay, so that's why I'll not do anything over here. Okay, next. After that, there is a entry called out as, for a string called out as 3, okay, which was the next used one, first in, first out. After 7, it was 2, okay. Take out 2, it was 0. Okay, take out that 0, replace it with 3. Okay, then it will be 2, 3, 1. Fine, getting to know. Okay, next, after this, what was the next item which was inserted? It was with 1. Okay, now what is the next entry I have? I have it as 0. So I replace 0 in the place of 1. Okay, next I have 4. Okay, after this particular 1, what was inserted? It was 2. Okay. That's why I take off 2 and insert 4. 4, 3, 0. Okay. Then what do? I remove 3. Okay. Then I allocate it as 4, 2, and 0. Okay. Next one is I remove 0. I get back here 3. Okay. It is 4, 2, and 3. Okay. After that, again 0. So 0 is taken the place of 4 now. Okay. So it will be 0, 2, and 3. Next, go to the next string. It is 3. Okay. So 3 is already there. Okay. So that's why I'll not do anything over here.
Next happens to be your 2. 2 is also there. Okay. So 2 is also there. Okay. So that's why I'll not replace anything over here also. Just come to the next one. Okay. So after this, I'll replace with 2. Okay. 2 is replaced with 1, 0, 1, 3. Then I replace 3. I take it as 0, 1, 2. Okay. Next 0. 0 is already there. 1 is also already there. I'll keep it as it is. Come back to 7. Okay. So 7 takes the place of 0 now. Okay. 7, 1, 2. Next 1 is replaced. Okay. With the value called out as 0. Next 2 is replaced with the value called out as 1. This is how your page replacement algorithm works. Okay. So your page replacement algorithm works when it comes across with and first in, first out. Okay. So totally how many page faults are there? 15 page faults. How are you getting this 15 there? 15 is got as this is your 1, this is 2, this is 3, this is 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Okay. 15 page faults. Okay. You can add more frames and which can cause more page faults there. So, as followed out with first in, first out, you have one more, next one. Okay, so that is optimal. Okay, so what do you mean by optimal now? Just to go across with the next one here. Optimal algorithm. Okay, what will it do is replace the page that will not be used for the longest period of the time further. Okay, so now here, first three frames will be allocated as usual, 701. Okay. Now 2 has come. Okay. 2 does not say replace 7. Okay. What will it say? Okay. See that amongst the 701, which is not used for a long period of time. Okay. 0 is used immediately. 1 is also used immediately. Which is not used? 7. So that's why I'll replace that 7 with 2. Okay. Next 0 is there. It's already in use. Okay. Next 3. Okay. So when you are replacing 3, see with the next respective context here. 0, it has been demanded further. Okay. So then next 4 is also demanded. Okay. 2 is also demanded here. Okay. But you can find that 1 is not demanded for a long duration of time. So I'll replace 1 with the 3. Okay. Similarly, come to 0. 0 is already there. Go back to the next one. Okay. It is 2. Okay. 2 for 4. Okay. So for 4, whether 2 is used, yes, 3 is also used, 0 is used as the least priority. Okay, so that's why I'll replace a 0 now. 2, 4, 3. Next, come to 2, it is already there. 3, it is already there. Come to 0. Okay, so when I come to 0, see with the further transmission. Okay, so 2 is used. Okay, so you are using 2 here in the further slide, in the further sections. You're using 4 also. Okay, you're not using 4 here. Then come back to 3. Are you using 3? Yes, 3 is also used. So what will I do? I'll replace this 4 with 0. Similarly, go on further. Come back here. Okay, 3 and 2 is already there. When it comes with a page replacement of 1. Okay, so which one do you find further? 2 is there, 0 is there. But 3 is not at all there. Let me replace 3 with 1. Next to 2 is there, 0 is there, 1 is there. Next comes 7. So when 7 comes, is 2 there in your further locations? No. 0 there? Yes. 1 is there? Yes. So what will I do? Instead of 2, I will reassign it with 7. Okay. Now how many page faults? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 9 page faults is being given here for this particular example. But one of the drawback with this optimal algorithm is we cannot decide regarding our algorithm's future. Or else we cannot read the future. So because of that, there was one more algorithm which was discovered, and that was least recently used algorithm. Least recently is nothing but I am seeing in back part now. Okay, so back part. So come across here, 7, 0 and 1, they are allocated as usual. Okay, then which was the least recently used now? Least means go to the last one. 7. So I'll replace that 7 with a frame called out as 2. Okay. Next 0, it is already there. Next 3. okay, which is the next recently next least used now. Zero is used immediate, so that's why I cannot change it. After zero, what was there? One was there. Replace one with three. Okay, come back to zero. Zero is already there again. Come back to four now. Okay, so four, I cannot have a replacement of with the zero. Okay, only because it has already been used here. Next comes two. I replace two with four now. Okay, 4, 0, 3. Okay, next similarly, with 4, 0, 3. Okay, go with the next allocation. Okay, when I'll be allocating this two, I'll look across which was least recently used. Least recently used is three. I'll take off three. I'll use it as two. Okay, next one. Okay, I go across with three that has to be used here. Okay, so when three has to be used, which has to be removed now? Which was least recently used? Zero. As compared to 4 and 2. Okay. So, I will remove that 0 and allocate 3. Okay. Then comes again 0 has to be allocated. Which happens to be the least used? 4. I will replace 4 with 0. Okay. Similarly, 3. 2. They are already there. Okay. Next comes 1. Okay. If 1 you want to allocate it, you go across with the least used one. Which is least used now? 0 is the least used. I remove that and add 1. Like this, if you go on replacing, we come across totally 12 faults there. Okay, which is, we say that it is better than FIFO, okay, but it is worse than your optimal. Okay, in optimal, when I used, I had 9 page faults. Okay, when I used FIFO, I had 15 page faults. But when I'm using this least recently used, okay, so I'm having 12 page faults. So ultimately, I say that it is worse than your OPT. And better than 50. Okay, so with respect to the same LRU algorithm, okay, so this is all what we are coming across. Okay, so in your further slides, okay, we'll come across with one more section is there with respect to your memory management, and that completes your memory virtual memory management. There is one more section wherein you are coming across to know what you mean by thrashing. Okay, so and one or two more problems we'll come across on these respective algorithms. Okay, thank you.